I have an announcement that please, after the panel is over, if you could exit through the side doors as opposed to the back. The crew is installing a red carpet outside. I guess there's a film festival with events happening. So please exit through the sides. I also want to thank our lead sponsor, lynda.com. For their amazing generosity, and then Pacifica Graduate Institute, who is sponsor of the panel. And without further ado, here are your panelists. David Magee, screenwriter for Life of Pi. Rian Johnson, screenwriter of Looper. John Gatins, Flight. Check out the hat. Roman Coppola, Moonrise Kingdom. Steven Chbosky, The Perks of Being a Wallflower. And your moderator, the lady who's owned and ruled this panel for the past years, we're so grateful to her, Anne Thompson, who is the editor of her own column, Thompson and Hollywood, in IndieWIRE.com. So enjoy.
So I've got my multimedia all set up here. So I'm looking all the way down at David Magee of Life of Pi.
Hello.
David, you're one of the people on this panel who's done an adapted screenplay along with you, Steven Chbosky. And I want you to explain why this particular adaptation took 10 years, and what it was, you know, what was the degree of difficulty, what was the real issue with making this into a movie, and how you licked it as a screenwriter?
Well, first of all, I want to make clear that I wasn't involved in all of those 10 years.
You helped to solve the issue.
I had some issues that I had to solve, and I didn't ever look at the previous drafts, so I don't want to say what worked or didn't. I have no idea how they came together, but the challenge with this particular book was that it's very episodic. It's written in 100 chapters. It's only a 300-page book, so you can imagine most of the chapters are nothing more than fragments, snapshots of different things in the life of Pi. And because so much of it is kind of a philosophical reflection on what he went through, and kind of static images of the suffering that he went through when he was on the boat, the challenge was to find an arc that carried you through that story for the character to go through. And in addition, it's hard to convince a studio that you want to make a film with a boy no one's ever heard of, an Indian boy in a boat with a tiger that's going to have to be created either by CG or through hundreds of hours of trying to convince a tiger to do what you really want him to do. So the cost of the film, you know, was going to be prohibitive if we made it anyway. So really, I think one of the biggest advantages we had is that Ang Lee came on and said, I want to direct it. And at that point, there was enough faith that something amazing was going to happen that they gave us the freedom to try and figure it out.
Rian Johnson, Looper, an original sci-fi screenplay of great complexity. This was a question of making a lot of very difficult things clear and concise enough. Explain that degree of difficulty. What were you facing as a writer on that?
Well, yeah, that was kind of like where most of the elbow grease went into is trying to make it as it's probably obvious, but making it as simple as possible, which may sound weird looking at the film, but it was especially when you have time travel that enters into a story. There's just a lot of work to try and figure out, and it's just. It's the same thing as, I guess, in writing any other kind of story where it's all just about figuring out how to tell the most with the least. But it's doing it with this concept of time travel. So that was kind of the main thing is, and also just kind of lashing yourself to the you know, to the mast of the story, and making sure you were never stopping what you hope the audience was actually caring about in the moment to explain something that may be neat but wasn't absolutely driving you forward. So,
and John Gatins, for you, this you've been writing for a long time. What was the degree of difficulty on flight? It was something you were resisting. It was something that was a challenge. Why?
You mean script-wise, like creatively in the script?
It's a long answer.
I'm going to let Rian Johnson answer that question.
Well, I had been through addiction in my own life, and so I...
He's doing great, actually.
That's sort of where I want you to go.
Oh, okay. Good. Rian will be my interpreter. I got sober when I was 25, so when I started writing this movie, I was 31, and I'm like 40... I'm 44. In Hollywood years, I'm 31 still. So I think that in the process of writing the story, it was, I had this whole kind of new worldview personally, and I have this tremendous fear of flying, or did. I mean, it kind of comes and goes. So it was kind of this weird fear and fascination with all of these elements in my life. I mean, I've described it as the marriage of my two greatest fears, which would be drinking myself to death or dying in a plane crash. So it was kind of just put those two things together and try to tell
easy peasy.
So no problem. Well, and go back. I could have gone back in time, too. Just saying.
So, Roman, you and Wes Anderson worked together on Moonrise Kingdom in a rather unusual collaboration. Explain how you got involved in helping him realize this movie.
Well, Wes had been working on this idea for some time, a couple of years. He had this notion, he called it the island movie, or I knew it as that. And it had to do with a scout running away and on an island. And he had this imagery and this notion. And of course, I've known Wes for some time, and we hang out together, and I keep asking him, how's the island movie going? And he said, well, I got some ideas. And ultimately, he was working on it, and he could only really get a couple of pages down, and he was a bit blocked, but he had this very clear sense in his mind, but it just wasn't taking shape quite yet. So we hung out, he put on this record of Benjamin Britten, he played it for me, I read the first five pages, and I was like, ah, I get it. And I just understood intuitively what it was, this world. And then we sat together, and slowly, I asked the right questions, I suggested a little something, we got that dialogue going, and from that point it was really that rush of like doing the crossword puzzle, and you get over that hump and you kind of know you're going to finish it, and that was very much the process.
All right, Stephen, you are adapting your own book, so you had the challenge of taking something that was incredibly successful as a book and turning it into a movie. And was that more difficult or more challenging than you expected?
Yeah, you know, what was challenging about it was the fact that when I wrote the book, I was 26, and when I started writing the screenplay, I think I was 37, and I'm 31 now. thank you. So, anyway, you know, it was because I was writing about young people, and I was more of an adult then. It was more of going back and doing the emotional work to actually respect and validate what young people go through on their own level. But at the same time, not treating the grown-ups like fools. So that was it. That was the only... going back was tricky. Plus, the fact that my book is a first-person epistolary novel is very intimate and very emotional to tell the same story with the same intent, but in a medium that is as literal as you can get. That was tricky. It took me some time.
All right. So we're going to go all the way back down again to David. And you and Aang met at a certain point. And how did he decide that it was you that needed to do this screenplay? And how did you proceed to work together?
I didn't actually ask him why he decided on me, because I didn't want him to rethink it. But
I got a call from my agent one day. Aang and I had talked about working on a different project earlier that never came about, and I kind of forgot about it. And then I got a call from my agent one day saying, "Do you ever read Life of Pi?" And I said, "Yeah, that's a hard one. I don't know if you could do that." And he said, "Well, Aang wants to direct it." And I said, "All right, let's do it. I'm in." And so we met the next night at a Japanese restaurant. I had sushi and talked about the book. And we had a lot of the same opinions about it. We had a lot of the we connected on it. And by the end of the meal, he said, "All right, let's do it." And it was very, you know, compared to so many projects where you have to jump through a certain number of hoops and get through certain hurdles to get the studio's attention and interest and set it all up, it was kind of, all right, let's do it, and we started. And I would write pages, and then he has a place in Manhattan, I live in New Jersey, so I'd come in once a week, I'd send him pages in advance, he'd read them, and then we'd sit around and eat Chinese food and talk all day. And then I'd come back with new notes and I'd write for another week, and that was the process, essentially.
There's a scene in the movie where Richard Parker vanishes mm-hmm. into the jungle mm-hmm. that I, for one, find incredibly emotional. It makes me cry. It's sort of the center of the movie for me. Mm-hmm. What is the reason? What is the, to me, that's the heart of the, do you agree that that's the heart of the movie? And what is the reason that there's so much emotion attached to that moment?
Whether you see the film as a literal story or as a kind of an allegory, Pi's connection to Richard Parker brings out something in Pi that he didn't know he had in himself. He's this, what he calls a skinny vegetarian boy who doesn't know how to survive outside the zoo when he begins this journey. And because he has to confront this tiger, he finds that side of himself within himself. And so when he, when that tiger leaves and doesn't look back, he's letting go of something that he found within himself that is never going to return necessarily. And I think that's why it's so poignant. I mean, also, if you have a cat that you love, I'm sure you have that kind of feeling too. But I think that's kind of the heart of why that's so strong emotionally.
Rian Johnson, there is a scene in your movie, Looper, where, and it's written in the screenplay as Joe and Old Joe. And I was wondering if Bruce Willis liked being called Old Joe.
No, we kind of started saying Older Joe on the call sheet very quickly. Yeah. Yeah.
So in that diner scene where the two of them are confronting each other, was that the most difficult scene you had to write?
Yeah, it was definitely the one that I worked on and kept working on the longest, and that was the one more than anything else in the script where we were working on it. Even like I got Joe and Bruce together, and we would spend weekends going over it and over it, and it's the one that changed the most, even leading up to shooting it, and probably the one that changed the most in post production too. So yeah, it was doing. It had to do a lot of things, and it also had to be a scene where it was just two characters sitting across from each other in the middle of basically like a sci-fi kind of action-y movie that didn't feel like it ground the whole thing to a halt. So yeah, a lot of going over it and over it.
John.
Yes.
So So talk about your process on flight. As a, you know, how long did it take you, and what do you do? You sit down, you have a notepad, you have a computer.
Not long, like 12 years. And it was a process of picking it up and putting it down for about 12 years. And you know, I did other movies in between to kind of, you know, feed the family, and you know, this was this strange little personal like Rubik's Cube that I would just pull out and try to fix and put away, and it was kind of scary. It was R-rated. It was, you know, and I'm an animal that kind of grew up in the studio system, so I kind of was at least savvy enough to know that this was going to be a challenge for a studio to embrace this R-rated drama that didn't have guns in it and things, you know. And so it was going to take the passion of one actor, you know, that to make the movie really kind of go. So.
And you wanted to direct it yourself.
I did. I tried for 10 years, not that successfully, ultimately, to direct the movie. And but in that, it had many lives. you know.
You had directed another movie, and,
yes.
and something changed in the way you were approaching your work after you directed that film?
Yeah, I mean, it was, it, you know, that movie, what was funny about that is that it's a movie called Dreamer, which was a family film that was PG and, you know, had Dakota Fanning and Kurt Russell, and then the studio said, well, what, we really had a nice time making a movie with you. We'd love to make another movie. What would you like to do? And I showed them the first 40 pages of Flight, and they were like, yeah, so what else would you like to do? You know, it was one of those, like, you know, so very tough. What was the question, Mother?
Well, you changed course after you directed Dreamer.
I did. I mean, I think that... Go a little further. What?
Because you had been doing pretty much studio fare, and
true.
You had been
true.
Going that route, sports
yeah.
movies and
yeah.
Cheerleading and so forth. So what you ended up deciding to change your
I did.
Your
I mean,
route.
I think it was, you know. Yeah. I wrote the movie, the greatest robot boxing movie ever made, called Real Steel.
Real Steel.
This year, anyway. And so this movie, as you asked before, Rian,
sorry.
Quiet, please. And I don't know. I mean, I think that, again, the personal nature of the movie also kind of scared me. So between the content, the idea of, like, the unclimbable mountain of trying to get this made in a studio system, because a lot of great movies get made outside of the studio system, and I knew nothing about that. So that was another thing that kind of terrified me in a way. So I was going to direct the movie, it seemed like it wasn't going to be in that system. So it was a very unknowable kind of thing.
So eventually you did get somebody who wanted to make it.
Yeah, thank God. And he's a Santa Barbara resident.
Denzel or Robert Zemeckis?
Robert Zemeckis. Robert Zemeckis. And Denzel, it was really the passion of those two guys that, like, made it happen.
And Zemeckis welcomed you in as a screenwriter.
He did. It was, like, an incredible thing. He's been so respectful, like, all along. He, you know, I got a phone call one day, and it was, I said hello, and it was said, John, it's Denzel. And I was like, yeah. And it was like, and I had the moment of, like, this is either Denzel Washington or Jay Farrow from SNL doing Denzel Washington. But I was like, you know what, either way, I'll go with it. Yeah, so, and I had dinner with him, and he said, I'm going to go make this movie Safe House, and when I come back, I want to make this movie. And then I get a phone call. It says, Robert Zemeckis wants to have lunch with you. So I drove up to Carpinteria and, you know, had lunch that turned into 6 hours of he and I in a room together. And in about hour three, he said, I need to ask you a serious question. He said, are you okay with me making this movie? I know you've tried to direct it for years. And I said, look, I can't get it done without you. I said, you know, and he said, good, then come with me. So it was this great, weird, for everything that went wrong for 12 years, there was like this one moment in time between the Denzel and the Zemeckis kind of lineup. It was great. So to get to be there the whole time was great.
So there was a moment where you were on an airplane and you
yeah.
were sitting next to a pilot. Tell us about that.
I was working on a movie called Behind Enemy Lines that had all these naval pilots in it, and I was flying back from Slovakia via Germany or I don't know, and there was this pilot sitting next to me who was in his pilot blues, but he was deadheading, as they call it, off duty, and he was chatting with me, and I'm a very friendly guy, but I just wanted this guy to shut up. You know, I was like, I don't, just quiet, shut up. And I was like, why do I want this guy to shut up? What I realized is, he's a pilot. I don't want to know anything about you personally. I want to think the guy or gal flying my plane's got their life perfectly in order. I was like, I don't want to know you're going through a shitty divorce or, like, your kids hate you. I was like, or you're an alcoholic. And I was like, wait a second. I had that aha writer's moment of, like, what if there was a guy who's circling the drain in his personal life? And I was like, say more. Could you tell me a little more? So, you know, so, but that was obviously the inception of the character. And then I wanted to put him in a severe flying situation. So then as a really nervous flyer, I started researching every plane crash possible, which I don't recommend. But those NTSB reports are public records, so you can, you know, read them ad nauseum. So
Roman, you worked with Wes on Darjeeling Limited.
Darjeeling.
So explain the difference between the collaborative process on that film and on this film.
For Darjeeling, which we wrote with Jason Schwartzman, who's my cousin, who appears in the movie, Wes had the kernel of the idea, which is, I want to do a story about three brothers that are kind of falling apart, and they go to India and have this crazy adventure. So he assembled our team, myself, Jason, and himself, and we started to, we cooked up the story in the process of kind of improvising and having late dinners and walking in strange neighborhoods. And ultimately, we went to India, we took a train, we went to a bunch of temples, and many of the people that are in the movie we met on the road as people who were in these temples and whatnot. So we kind of grew the movie through improv and through experiences that we shared, and we kind of created the condition for the story to happen through the writing team, the three of us, and we each had our guy. I was Peter, the Adrian Brody character. So that was a very distinctive experience. For Moonrise Kingdom, we were in a house together, a rented house, and it was much more having to do with imagination and fantasy, and people will ask, oh, well, what about that movie is real? What happened to you? And the answer, as we've discovered, is really nothing really happened. It's all what we wished would have happened. You meet a girl in fourth grade, and you would love to run off with her. So it's not based on any real experience, but it's based on these fantasy notions and recalling those times of being a child. So it was more that type of work, just daydreaming and improvising. And we were in this house together, and my girlfriend was there, and Wes's girlfriend and Wes's brother, and they were sort of our audience. So we would work during the day, we'd go have our meal in the evening, and we would tell the next installment, and it was sort of like a radio drama. And we had that fun of knowing they'd be there to share the next installment, so that was brought a lot of pleasure to it.
So who's in charge of the computer what is the legitimate, you know, the actual...
The device?
Yeah.
Wes is in charge of that. He is the director of the film, and so he and I are the writers in service of the director. So, you know, I'm very much there to serve the director. And so we would banter and come up with all these strands of dialogue and little pieces, and then when it sort of felt right, then Wes would be the ultimate person to put it into, you know, into actual words.
So I love the idea. Did you stay involved through the production? And you help a lot of people do their films. You help your sister. You produce her films. You help. You've done visual effects for your father. Mm-hmm. You've done. You have your own company, and you do commercials and music videos, mm-hmm. and all this stuff. But you've done a lot of second unit work, and you are a jack of all trades and a writer. You want to direct as well. I saw your first film, CQ, which was in Cannes. I remember interviewing you then, and I loved it.
Oh, good.
So what?
Well, now you have to see my next film. It's coming out.
So tell everybody about that.
I get to do a plug. I have a new film coming out that I wrote and produced and directed. It's called A Glimpse Inside the Mind of Charles Swan III, starring Charlie Sheen as Charles Swan. Jason Schwartzman, Bill Murray, Patricia Arquette, and some other folks are round out the cast. And it's a portrait of a guy going through a tumultuous time as he's dealing with a breakup. So it's coming out February 8th. Check it out.
So, Stephen, in the course of figuring out how you were going to get this, what is your process? What is your day-to-day writing? When do you get up? How do you do it? What's the mechanics of it?
Day-to-day, I get up, my mind is clear in the morning, and so I just go, and I mean, it's not terribly sexy. I just go to the computer like around 10 in the morning, and then I write till about 2 or 3.
It's nonstop.
Yeah, well, you know, there's lunch, you know. I'm human. I'm not one of the boxers from Real Steel. But yeah, no, I'll do that. And you know, I've written a lot of different things in my career. I've done television and movies and some musicals and other things. And each one begs for a different process. But generally in the morning, it's the only time. By the afternoon, my head is crowded.
So you directed the film The Four Corners of Nowhere that went up to Sundance. Is that the name of it?
Yes.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Which went up to Sundance. How did that help you to be able to do this one? You know, what did you must have gotten some skills out of that.
You know, I was so young when I did that movie. I wrote it when I was 22 and directed it when I was 23. You know, I don't know what I got out of it other than it took me... Because my joke about my first movie is like that half of it's really good, you know, and half of it's really bad. And so, honestly, very little. Other than there is a certain, you know, when you start a movie, you have very grand thoughts about shots and performance, this, that, and the other. And by the end of shooting, you're thinking, that stuff has been taken care of itself. You're thinking about minutes and hours and how do I actually get it done? You know, how do I boil the coverage so I'm going to have, I got to make sure that Emma has enough takes because I know that she's nervous about the scene, or Ezra wants to try some improv, so how can I carve out a little bit more time? Or at the end of the day, really, just how do you just, you know, get your job done?
So did you write the music into the screenplay? There's a lot of music.
I wrote a lot of the music into the screenplay. I knew that, I mean, Rocky Horror Picture Show, those songs were a big part of the book and a big part of the film. The Smiths' Asleep, for sure. I knew that the Homecoming Dance would be Come on Eileen by Dexy's Midnight Runners, because I, you know, we choreographed it to that song. You know, Air Supply, because, you know, you have to have Air Supply. But otherwise, past that, it was just my music supervisor and I, just, you know, and our music editors seeing which songs worked best in the film.
So what would you, how would you define the major difference between the movie and the book, the biggest change you made?
The biggest change, I think, was that the book, because screenplays are so unforgiving structurally, you have to find the center. And if you veer off too much or if you don't make things clear, you're going to lose the audience really quickly. So the biggest difference was, in the book, I could talk about Charlie's extended family. I could talk about his grandfather. I could talk about the history of the family and all these things and some of his thoughts about the world or pop culture or whatever. And there was room to do it. But in a movie, you can't. And so I just focused on Charlie, his past, his friends, and his immediate family.
Okay. Back to David. So one of the more controversial, if you like, things about Life of Pi is the use of the bookended narrator. Mm-hmm. Some people buy it, some people like it, some people don't. Mm-hmm. Explain why that was the only way to tell the movie, to tell the story of the movie.
I don't know if it was the only way. It was something that Aang felt strongly about that first dinner that we had. And from the very beginning, Aang and I both agreed that the story was not just about religion. It was about the power of storytelling. It was about the power of stories to get you through the chaos in your lives. And so we were very attached to the idea that this was, the older Pi was a storyteller. He was not just someone recounting what had happened in his life. He was someone who was able to bring something to life in a more magical way, which you wouldn't have had if you were telling the story from the boy's point of view, the young Pi's point of view. If he were recounting that to those Japanese investigators, and that was the bookend device of the film, it would be him just recounting what had just happened to him in the aftermath of great turmoil. And it's a very different story when something is told right after the fact than it is something that's evolved over time, that you've remembered certain parts, that you've enriched certain parts of the story. It's a different kind of story. And so for us, that was important. And also the idea that it was one storyteller passing a story on to another storyteller became very important for us. So ultimately, that was what determined that. And we tried different variations along the way, but that was the strongest way to tell it.
Now, this is a bit of a spoiler for those of you who have never read Life of Pi or seen the movie, so I apologize, because I'm assuming everybody has, I hope. But at the end of the movie, it is revealed that there are two versions of this story. Was there mm-hmm. ever any consideration, given that it was a movie, a fiction movie, of abandoning story number two?
We would never have abandoned story number two. No, the very point of the film was, however we were going to tell it, the very point is that no one knows what happened on that boat except for Pi. And so what story you believe says a lot about how you interpret what he went through. If you as a person believe that you know, there is a God watching over us who will help us through the ordeals in our lives, as Pi does, then that's how you're going to read that story. That's how you'll interpret what happened to you on that story, on that journey. And If you favor the kind of scientific, this happened and then that happened, this was the result of meteorological conditions, this was an accident of nature, this was the failure of a ship's hull in a storm, dry facts, then that's how you're going to read the story. We were not trying to tell you this is the right version or that's the right version. And I was actually surprised in some reviews, people said, well, obviously they came down on one side or the other, and I never knew which side they thought we came down on. What we were trying to say was, everyone has a narrative that they bring to their lives, whether you're a Hindu, whether you're a Christian, whether you're an atheist, a scientist, whatever. You've built a safety net about in the facts that you've, the things that you've concluded about why the world works the way it does, and those were what get you through your ordeals.
So one of the challenges was having this guy on a boat in the middle of the ocean for, you know, virtually alone with a CG tiger for this length of time. How did the guy who was a sailor that you found help you?
Steve Callahan.
Thank you.
Yeah, he, right after we started working on it, my nephew mentioned to me that he had read a book by a guy who had been lost at sea for 76 days in a 5-foot round rubber dinghy, saying, you know, life raft. And so we tracked him down up in Maine. And Steve had been in his, he was a professional sailor. He had gone over for a sailing race in France. And on his way back, he thinks a whale hit the underside of the boat and it sank. And he threw out his supplies and his raft and inflated it. And all he had on was a t-shirt. And he spent the next couple of months at sea. And so we went to talk to him, and I mean, I can't tell you how much insight he gave us into the mechanics of what something like that is like, but he also gave us the kinds of imagery. You know, we said, it was constant ordeal, obviously horrible what you went through, and he said, yeah, but there were also times when there were no clouds, it was the middle of the night and the sea was calm and the stars were reflected in the water and you felt like you were in a giant globe at the center of the universe. And, well, all right, that's great, that's in the movie. You know, that kind of stuff you cannot find or come up with on your own. And those kinds of moments, those images, I mean, he knew everything from the, you know, he knew the facts about the flying fish, about the phosphorescence in the water, about the way the stars looked. And he was our marine consultant throughout the film, figuring out exactly where he was on his journey and everything. He stayed with us throughout the entire process.
So he gave you that thing where he's able to write in the journal and
yes,
all that.
Yes, yeah. Steve, because he was a sailor, he was writing in tiny lettering in a little notebook. He was figuring out the wind speed and the direction of the waves and where he must be according to the stars. He was trying to calculate exactly where he was in the ocean when he was in different shipping channels. Pi didn't have any of that knowledge, but when we were looking for a way to show Pi kind of reflecting on what he was going through, we found that he could keep a journal by writing in his survival manual, and so that was a device we borrowed directly from Steve.
Yeah. So, Rian, explain sci-fi, the way that genre fed your movie and inspired it, and the role of sci-fi in your movie, and then also I'd like to know more about the two halves of the movie and how you got from sort of hard-boiled action part one to mother-son part two.
Sure. I guess in terms of sci-fi, it was most of the sci-fi that I grew up really loving, like Ray Bradbury or Philip K. Dick, it's always stuff that uses these otherworldly concepts in order to get to something incredibly immediate and recognizable and human at the heart of it. And so when I think of sci-fi, that's what sci-fi means to me. It doesn't mean big and crazy. It actually means something that uses something that feels very mythic to get at something very, very personal. So that was always kind of the way what I tried to do with this. And then what was it? What was the second thing? Yes.
How you got the structure? You have a structure.
Oh yeah. So basically, the whole movie is set up as this conflict between these two guys, between the older and younger version of himself. And I actually wrote the film originally as a short script, as like a 4-page script like back before I made my first film, Brick, 10 years ago, I wrote it as something that I was just going to make with my friends on the weekend. And I never ended up making it. And it's just sat in a drawer until after we made Brothers Bloom. I took it out and expanded it. But the short that I wrote, which if anyone's curious, just Google it. I put it up on the film's website, and you can download and take a look at this short and see kind of the origin of it. But it was just the two guys. It didn't have the second half of the movie that was the daughter and the mother and the son. And for me, it was, I don't know, when I was expanding it out, I was thinking, okay, I need to show what's different about these two, show the basic conflict, and show how they kind of, you know, work to their different ends and the conflict between them. And to me, I figured, well, you could either do that by having them chase each other more and shoot at each other more, or team up and buddy up or something like that, or you could give them both the same problem. You could give them both the same thing to deal with in the second half and then see how they each deal with it and explore how they're different in that way. So that's the way I went at it. It was introducing that... the element of the kid and the mother, and it's kind of giving them both the same dilemma and seeing how where they come down on at the end of it. It was all a way of kind of, I thought, getting much deeper into the heart of exploring the conflict between our two main guys.
You've worked with Joseph Gordon-Levitt now for quite a few years. Just give us a sense of your response to what has happened to him and how he's grown and what the new Joseph Gordon-Levitt brought to this movie as opposed to what you worked with him on in Brick.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, we've stayed really, we're really good friends, you know, since we made Brick together. So it's hard. It's not like he's gone through any kind of, I mean, just as his friend, it's not like he's been through a big transformation or something. It's been fun seeing him do very well at what he does. And it's really, it's always fun seeing a friend of yours do well because they're doing what they do well for the right reasons. And I think that's the thing with Joe, is he, you know, he only chooses stuff based on whether it, you know, gets his motor running, I guess, you know, whether he's truly passionate about it. And that's why he chose Mysterious Skin, and that's why he chose the Batman, he wanted to do the Batman movie. He gets excited about something and throws himself into it. So there's, from just as his friend, it's not so much a transformation as kind of just seeing a buddy of yours, you know, do really well.
So did he show you stuff on John's Addiction?
Oh, yeah.
Which just premiered at Sundance? Did
you
help him with
movie.
That?
Yeah, I read the script and then got to see a few cuts of it, and I'm so proud of him. I think it's a really great film. And it's a really, especially for an actor who's a young actor who's kind of in the public eye, to do something that out there and that stylized and kind of go for what he went for. I think it's a tremendous movie.
So, hear what Roman has to say as well, because, you know, I came to California, I came to LA in 1990 to be an actor right out of college. And those years of, like, you know, starring in Leprechaun 3. They, you know, I just think that, you know, it's Ryan, would you like to answer this for me?
Well, Leprechaun 3 was a unique challenge because...
I think in truth, look, I remember having a meeting with Diane Lane, who was, you know, the director, said, oh, come along. And she was like talking to him, and then she just looked at me and she goes, you're an actor. And I was like, well, you know. And she said, no, I like people who've suffered from both sides, is what she said, in earnest, you know. And I think that when I'm on a movie set, I tend to kind of, I have an easy way of talking with actors. It's like I kind of understand, kind of, even with someone like Denzel, who, you know, it was unbelievable to watch him do what he does and how he does it. And I was constantly kind of looking over his shoulder, like he would always calibrate in every scene how drunk he was. Like he had a number scale. I never knew what it was, but I knew that he was working off this metric that he had, and I was like, God, that's amazing. But it's like, I'm just a hacky actor, but it's like watching him do that and thinking like, wow, I don't know how to do, well, there it is. And so, but I guess what I'm saying is that, you know, it was very helpful because if you play different roles on a production, which I've been able to do, and I know others here have, it's very helpful. You know, it's definitely a helpful thing because showing up on a movie set, you know, as a writer for the first time was a much different experience than being there as an actor. So You know, and I think the business has changed, and it kind of asks you to be a little bit of a shape-shifting, you know.
Yeah. Roman?
I'm just a curious person, so the things that I've pursued have just been the things that have caught my eye and often an invitation. You know, when Wes said, hey, do you want to come to India and make this thing? I said, oh, it sounds great. And so I don't really think about it. I mean, as you asked the question, you reflect a bit, and it is nice to have that kind of diverse experience. And I agree with John that you know, having been in front of the camera or being savvy about effects or whatever it might be, brings, you know, is very useful to other aspects of your work. So, but my answer is really that I just kind of go where I'm called.
So you, did you write the script for the movie you just made yourself?
Yeah.
So what was that like?
Well, I work much differently than Wes. When we work together, it's a different process. He's very meticulous. He keeps a notebook or a series of notebooks, depending on the book as he's always used. I have tons of papers and computers, and I save files with wrong names and kind of a wreck. And so I'm just a little more chaotic kind of thinker and person. This movie, the Charles Swan film, took me about 8 years or so to write and figure out. A lot of it, as John said, is, you know, you put it down, you process over time. And I think that actually informs the movie, because it's a very kaleidoscopic, odd movie, that the fact that it took me so long maybe kind of informs what it is. But, you know, in simple terms, you have this little nugget of a kernel of inspiration, and you just use that as your compass, and you say, does that belong, does that fit with that? And you just, yeah, it does, and you go forward. And when you're in a groove and you're inspired, anything around you, you can grab and apply yes or no to that little compass, and it guides you, and you just go towards the target.
Stephen? As far as being a multi-hyphenate and having different knowledge sets.
Yeah, you know, I feel that as a writer, and I come at it from a writing point of view, having all the writing all the different types of things, it's helped my career a great deal. There's the practical thing, of course, which is it's wonderful if all I did were screenplays. You know, screenwriting is a tough, tough job. And most of the stuff that you do, unfortunately, doesn't get made, and so it can get frustrating. Whereas television, it's you know, your chances are a little bit better, and novels are a little bit better. But what I found, that's just practical. Artistically.
So Jericho was your big TV series.
Yeah, Jericho was my TV show. And, you know, but artistically, actually, for Perks Being a Wallflower, it's interesting because I wrote the novel and then the screenplay, and there's ten years between. And had I not written pilots, I'd written, by that point, three pilots. I don't think I could have adapted Perks, because pilots, the very nature of what they are is you have 42 minutes to introduce 12 characters, 15 characters, introduce a world and an arena, make us understand everybody and actually want to watch more. And so there are tricks to that. And those tricks helped me enormously with introducing Charlie and making us know and care about his friends instantaneously. And as a director, directing is actually very close to being a novelist, because a novelist is, you're creating the entire world, the whole vision, you know so much about every character and backstory of every character, and that's much more like what a director does.
Cool.
Yeah.
So before
thank you.
Before we go to the questions.
Can I just for a second? Just one question for John.
Go for it.
What is Warwick Davis like?
Short.
There you go. There you go.
He's awesome.
Yeah. Great. I bet he is.
No. Now I've I wanted to ask Roman a question. I have a little question for Roman. Roman, so I understand that on Moonrise Kingdom, I was struck by this for some reason. You guys Googled a lot. You did a lot of research using Google, including locations.
That was really after the writing. When Wes was looking for the location, so there'd be some Google map searching and looking for an island that was appropriate and the type of house that he was looking for. But that didn't really happen in the writing. It was more in the
And did you get involved in the creation of the children's books and the kind of different elements that had to be created for the world?
Not any of the visual stuff. This is Darjeeling, I attended the shoot. I was one of the producers. As a second unit director, I was there every day. For this film, I wasn't around during the shooting, and it was a wonderful experience to go. I saw a cut of the movie, but then to see it complete in Cannes in a beautiful auditorium with great sound, so that was a real treat that I've never really had the pleasure of, to see it presented as a complete thing. But the text that appears in the movie, Wes and I wrote together, the excerpts of the children's books, but the visual presentation was all his work.
That makes sense. Okay, we've got mics. We got a mic here and a mic there. You can line up and ask questions to this remarkable panel. You, sir, number one.
I think this is on. Yeah. So, Rian, quick question.
Yes.
First of all, thank you for making an original sci-fi film. Very enjoyable. Much appreciated. I read an early draft of the script. I don't know if it was earlier, the draft that's online for, you can easily get, but it's the diner scene that you had originally had, like, straws and salt between it explaining time travel, and what ended up in the movie was just kind of like, you kind of just threw it away in a sense, and I actually really loved the decision. It was kind of less is more kind of thing and explaining that, but did that come about with Joseph Gordon-Levitt? Did that come about Bruce Willis, or just a collaboration, or your thought? Like, where did that come from?
No, we actually, and thanks, I'm glad you took it to me. We actually shot that, and actually, if you buy the Blu-ray on shelves, it's on there as a deleted scene. We actually, everything that was in the first, that draft that you read in the diner scene, we actually shot, and the trimming down of it was all in the editing room, and it was just a process of just being increasingly brutal, as it always is with cutting, and just saying what is absolutely necessary, what can we live without, and what is neat but not part of the spine. So thanks, man. Thanks a lot, man.
Go ahead.
This is also for Rian. Many time travel movies are great on the first pass, but then when you stop and think about them, they don't make any sense at all. but yours does, and it's very tight. Can you talk about, was there anything that you had written initially, but then you thought about it and thought, well, but that doesn't work. I have to redo it.
Yeah, I appreciate that, man. I did take, that's the funny thing, I spent a lot of time when I was writing making sure that, whenever you do time travel, it really is more of a fantasy element than a sci-fi element. It's more like Harry Potter spells than it is like science. Like, your job is to create a framework, and within that framework, stick to your rules and make sure it makes sense in that framework. And so I just spent a lot of time making sure that it worked in that realm. But then we didn't have like a blackboard scene where we explained it all. We kind of just showed it operating. And so it makes me very happy to hear that it felt like it all was cohesive for you. Yeah.
New York University?
Yeah. So my question's for Roman. I'm currently a sophomore at NYU, and I was just asking, I think you went to NYU too. Mm-hmm. What did you do at NYU or during film school that you thought really advanced your career? What were the right things to do?
Well, I first went to NYU and I was in the cinema studies department because it was easier to get into than the film program. But it was actually wonderful because you just
That's where I went too.
Yeah. You just get to watch movies and discuss them. So it was a wonderful time. I really enjoyed that. So I would recommend that type of class. And then NYU, of course, is famous for Sight and Sound, the class in which you just go and make movies. And I met a lot of great friends. Richard Shepard, who's a filmmaker, did Matador, was a classmate. And so that was a wonderful friendship. And that was fun just to get in there and do it. So that those are the things that come to mind.
Just do one more. I guess, what was your plan on coming out of film school? Like, did you want to just go into commercials or music videos or feature independent films?
I just sort of jumped into doing stuff at whatever level, and I made a music video for the band I was in, and one thing led to another. But my advice when people ask, like, how do you get started in the film business and what path to take, I always just say, just do it at whatever level. Do it with your friends, do quasi-professionally, in whatever way, with whatever tool. And if you do something you love, you tend to get good at it, and you have the pleasure of doing the thing you love. So as your life progresses, you look back and say, wow, look, I did all these wonderful things. And if it leads to a career, then that's fantastic.
Thank you.
You know, my niece is a sophomore at NYU, and she's at school right now. Carrie. Her name is Carrie.
I think he's making a different point. No. Go ahead. Go ahead.
She goes to Tish. I'm just saying, she's at school. Okay. This one starts over. Monday. All right.
Starts Monday.
This question is for Steven. It's pertaining to Jericho. If you're approached by a company like Netflix or Hulu to essentially revive the show, would you consider it? And if so, would you? How would you continue the story now that Jake Green is in Texas, out of Cheyenne?
You know, Jericho. Listen, if you know, we have an agent, a wonderful agent, Corey Wellens at WME, who represents me and John Turteltaub and some other people, and they've been talking to Netflix, and you never know. So I can't, you know, say what it'll be for season three, because I'd say is like, if you really, really want to know, the comic book is you know, it's telling the further story. You know what I mean? Because, yeah, I mean, spoiler, you know. It's like, yeah. You. Sure, buddy. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Afternoon. I was wondering if any or all of you could elaborate upon your outlining and planning process and kind of what you go through before you put some words on paper.
Good question. Yes. Let's start with David at the bottom and work down the line.
Well, because I worked on adapting something, I'll just say in terms of that, what I do is as I read the book, and as I read it, I write down all the actions that happen on every page as briefly as possible so that when I'm done, I have a very concise description of the things that happen as opposed to the beautiful sets and scenery and stuff like that. And it helps get the book in your head, and that's a starting place for writing the outline, at which point I do what he's going to describe. Go ahead.
I outline extensively, and all that. It's really like 85% of the process for me is, and I write, I'm carrying it around now, I write in these things, I just carry it around, and so by the time I sit down, I basically have a draft of the script already written, basically, in pretty great detail, and then typing it into the computer is kind of my first editing process in a way.
Yeah. Ryan and I are friends elsewhere. I mean, also, in addition to.
Let's not get crazy.
Kind of. But so, I mean, I know that he actually sketches and draws, and he carries those books around, these magical little books, and then, you know, he makes these great, interesting movies. I'm a bad outliner, but I have to, so, because I have that weird thing of like I want to find it on the page, so I'm the guy who writes myself into corners and then has to figure out how to write out of it, and then so I do a lot of editing. So I'm a big rewriter. I think that that's really kind of, you know, my skill is really in rewriting. It's like the initial draft process is like root canal without Novocaine. It's like it's really painful. It's really painful.
John, how many drafts of Flight did you write?
I honestly don't know. I mean, hundreds, probably. I mean, there was like, and it's funny because like they printed the script, you know, because they give it around or whatever, and it's like the studio said, it's 149 pages. They're like, was it actually 149 pages? Like, really? That was it? It's like, because it was where, I mean, there was drafts that were way longer than that, and that's too long. That's not.
Should
I jump in? I've worked in a lot of different ways, and for some other personal work I've outlined for Moonrise Kingdom, there was no outline. There was just the story began, and we just scrambled after it as it was written. So it was just done, just asking ourselves what happens next, and then we figured that out and proceeded.
I think for me, my goal with first, I always want my first draft to read like a second draft, and so. So what I try to do is, with detail, like, you know, people do step outlines, they'll just list what scenes are. So what I do is, I don't actually do that on a document, I do that in a folder, like let's say on your Mac or something. And each document, like let's say there's a scene heading or a chapter heading, I'm writing a novel now, a chapter heading, and that document will be every thought that could maybe be this for this scene. So I do have the basic outline of the basic snapshot of what I think it's going to be, but then I can go down the rabbit hole in each moment because I'm always trying to find details, kind of like what Roman was describing, where it's a what happens next type of thing.
What kind of software do you use, screenwriting software?
Final Draft.
You, Roman?
Yep.
Everybody?
Yeah. Yep.
Unfortunately, yeah.
Go ahead.
I want to tell you real quickly a little about my background before I ask a few questions, because I have a really, really bad attitude towards the industry, and I don't want you to think the attitude is toward any of you, because I respect all of you equally, and I'm just going to ask a few questions, and anybody can answer it. But quickly, I have such a bad experience towards it. You know, I'm a spiritual guru now, but I started out trying to be an actor, and I studied with Lee Strasberg 8 years, and I would just compete for parts in the theater, and but as far as film, but I never got an agent, went out looking for parts, but I would take the parts when they fell in my lap. And since I've had such a long, long journey and not any results with the movie,
could we? Good. Could we get to the question?
I got two quick questions. I submitted my screenplay to Fred Williamson. He ripped it off. John Cassavetes, he ripped it off. All that stuff turned me off. So my question is, once those experiences happened, I didn't know how I would go directly. They're producers, so I figured if you go straight to them, you know, you're doing it right. Would you suggest having an agent take your scripts and get them to producers, or, you know, try to take them there yourself? And the question is this, I just met.
Let's start with that.
The question is, would any of you be open, because I talked to Quentin Tarantino.
So here's a,
let's just ask that one question. This is.
Well, if the question is, sir, if the question is about agents and if agents are the better way to go, I'd say everybody on this panel would agree that they absolutely are, because the truth is, I guarantee you that every one of us have had very, very bitter experiences, very difficult experiences. It's a really tough business. We all know it. This is probably, I think it's probably all of our kind of best year that we've had. Talk to any of us 3 years ago, and we might have been very discouraged. So I hope you're not, you know, feeling too badly about what you're doing. That's why I think going to agent is the best plan, because they'll take a lot of the brunt for you, and the part of all of us artists who get sensitive and our feelings get hurt and this, that, and the other, they help bear the brunt of that. So that's what I would say.
We're going on to the next question right here.
All of you gentlemen pointed out that you use Final Draft, and I was curious, being a former film student, I was taught that Sid Field is kind of the standard in the industry, and that there's this three-act structure, and there's just a certain way that you have to format everything, otherwise things just kind of get thrown away in the industry, and they don't even look at it. I guess my question is kind of a two-part question. I'm starting my first screenplay, and I want to do it properly. I want to, you know, do it in a format or whatever, not just with Final Draft, but also in the structure that they suggest, the three act or whatever. But at the same time, I'm wondering, is that just a cliche kind of thing? Is there more room? Is there more room where somebody, like, for instance, in Pulp Fiction, you can kind of move things around and what you kind of think should be traditional in the mainstream to something more out of the box, or are we limited?
I think that, you know, every story has a beginning, a middle, and an end. I mean, I have to make it as simple as that for me when I try to write a script, because, you know, as Stephen has said, it's like it's a very small, contained box you have to kind of work in, so it has to be kind of precise, but it doesn't have to be told in that order. You can tell it in any order you want. So if I can start with an idea that I know what the beginning, middle, and an end, that's great. I usually can't get that far, but if I can get that far, then at least I have a start. But I think that, you know, and that's why the outlining question, I'm thinking about as we're sitting here and I'm listening to everybody talk about it. You know, the outlining thing for me is, I don't want to know necessarily where it's going all the time. If I know what that next thing, that middle piece I have to get to is, because, you know, happy accidents happen along the way. If I'm writing about something and I'm saying, wait a second, what if they go there? It's like, and then I go, and then sometimes that's an appendage I get rid of because it doesn't work and it just drags us nowhere, but it's like, and then sometimes it becomes something else. And the perfect example, if you've seen the film that I'm here for, is the cancer patient in the stairwell. It's not like it was, but that would have never been part of an outline. Would have been like, oh, and of course they're just going to stand there for 10 minutes and talk to this guy who's dying of cancer. It's like, that's going to happen. It's like, no, it came up because it was like I needed them to meet. And like they're in a stairwell smoking a cigarette, and then I don't know, it just kind of, this guy kind of appeared. So that was a little bit of a happy accident, but that wouldn't have ended up on an outline, but I need a roadmap to get me to like the big pieces of the story.
Really quickly, is what you ask, are you asking about the format on the page and how it's supposed to look, or just any structural? Is it artistic or formatting?
I think she's sort of asking if she should follow Sid Field or be more creative.
Right, and then it's kind of a two-part question I was hoping to also ask. They say write what you know, and obviously there's some inspiration maybe from personal life that you guys were sharing earlier, or from inspiration from people sharing their personal life stories, and that I guess is the combination of my question is, is are you limited to a certain way of beginning, middle, and end three-act structure, or can the end be in the beginning?
Here's the thing. There are rules. There are definitely rules, and Sid Field has some of them, and he's articulated them. There's Save the Cat. There's a lot of really good books about it. But there are no, like you say, like, is there a thing where the ending is the beginning? Yeah, it's called Annie Hall, and it's amazing, you know? Mm-hmm. So there really are, in terms of the basic rule that I would say I would follow, and I'm sorry if I cut anybody off, is does it hold our interest? Because mm-hmm. the rules are there, and other writers like ourselves, and people I'm sure out in the audience, we are making up the rules like all the time. It's like I imagine somebody would say, God, I really want to tell a story about young people, and they will watch Perks, and they'll watch Moonrise Kingdom. I would imagine Rian looked at Back to the Future and said, okay, did this thing work, and how did it work for my thing, for Looper? So we're making up the rules, and at the end of the day, if you have a basic understanding of it, it helps you, but then break it and make it more interesting and show a different shape. It's always great. You'll stand out. I think.
Does anyone else have an answer?
I'll throw a quote out from Thomas Edison, who said, there are no rules here, we're trying to do something. I would say, go for it.
So, you guys have inspired me. I'd like to run down the panel and ask, what do you do when you're stuck, when you have writer's block? What are your tricks for solving that impasse? Because we all get it.
I surf the web first, and then when I get bored with that, I realize that I have three kids I have to feed, and so I'd better just put something down. And I mean, I'm serious about that. I just write something. Even if I write, I don't know what I'm doing, this is really bugging me because, and I just kind of start listing what's not working, it usually I get somewhere. Or I drink.
Brian?
Yeah, I drink.
I want more than that. More.
I go to rehab.
Yeah. No, it's kind of the same thing. I think it does help to take stuff in when you're stuck, to go to a movie that has nothing to do with what you're writing, or to go to a museum or read a book or something. But then at the end of the day, you do hit a point where you do have to just start scribbling and start, you know, and 9 times out of 10, that gets you back on track.
The only way out is through, as they say. So ultimately, that's.
Ooh. You outdid us, didn't you?
I was going to quote who told me that, and he's a mutual friend of ours, but I'm not. I'm just going to own it. Cut that out.
I often will just start another project and try, you know, then to come back to it, or look at something that's inspiring. If I'm working on a film, you know, to see something I know, something like Annie Hall, for example, I could watch that over and over, and you see something that inspires you, then you can pick up little clues from it and maybe use that to help you unblock.
Annie Hall, someone else on this panel is a huge Annie Hall fan. Is that you, Rian?
Yeah.
What is it about Annie Hall? Why are you guys all mentioning Annie Hall?
The ugly guy got the hot girl. You know what I mean? Thank you. That's universal, man. That's like, that's a screenwriter. Like, come on, you know.
I mean, there's a lot of things about it. I guess if I had to say one thing, just in terms of screenwriting, it's something that is magical to me, because it does seemingly break all the quote unquote rules, I guess. But it works in every conceivable way, and it works on this way that it really is. You feel like you're a kid watching somebody do a magic trick, and it's magic. You have no idea how it pulls off what it does, and it's just a gorgeous piece of art that just infiltrates your life and means more to you each time you see it as you go on in life. It's one of those, I think. So,
Annie Hall. All right, go ahead.
Can I answer the stuck question?
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Did you go ahead?
No, no. Only because I actually think it's somewhat valuable because it's completely changed from directing my movie. I no longer get stuck, and only because when you're cutting a movie, before I got stuck all the time. Once I had my footage and I knew I had however many weeks, 20, 24 weeks, to make it into a final version, and you just went, and there were some days that nothing was working, and you just go in every day, 10, 12, sometimes 14 hours, because you know you have to, because someday they're going to pull the plug and you have to finish. And I found that very freeing, and now that as I'm writing new things, I just apply the same discipline. And you realize sometimes if you're inspired, that's when it's the best, but if you're not inspired, it's a really good job and keep doing it like a job. Because, you know, when my grandfather was a steel worker, it's not like he was like, I just don't feel it today.
Yeah.
You
true.
Know?
This is a question for anyone. During your early years of writing and now, when you conceived of an idea for a character, who did you most trust and enjoyed developing this character with?
The actors, I would say. You know, I didn't hear the first part of the...
During your early years of writing and now when you would come up with an idea for a character, who did you trust to discuss the development of the character with?
No one.
With the three other personalities that live in your mind at any given point.
Yeah.
Right?
No, especially when I was first writing, for me, I was trying to figure something out. I still didn't know how to write, and I was very nervous about showing my work to other people. So I just kept going back to the character and back to the character, and some of those characters never turned into films or anything, but they're still kind of haunting me. You know, there are a couple of characters that I spent ages thinking about, and I hope they find a venue someday.
Yeah.
So, David, you have an unusual trajectory as far as becoming a writer, a screenwriter. Mm-hmm. You were a voice actor.
Yes.
And you decided that some of the abridged versions of the books you were doing the voices for, you could do a better job?
Right. I was a theater actor, earned no money, and I had to support myself doing voiceover, and I narrated those audiobooks that you listen to in your car. And as I was narrating one day, you do the full length, which is 105,000 words, runs 12 hours or something, and then you do the abridged version, which is 29,500 words, and it runs 3 hours. And whoever had written the abridgment had just done a horrible job of it. I mean, people were teleporting all over the place, and it was weird. It was horrible. And I said to the producers, I feel bad for this author. They've ruined this book. I could do better than this. And they said, well, would you like to try? We'll pay you. Yeah. And I said, sure, okay, I'll try it. And I abridged about 85 novels over the course of 5 years.
Wow.
So, wow. I don't know if that deserves applause or not. I ruined 85 books in my own special way.
But you learned some skills.
But I learned a lot about craft. I learned a lot about structure and a lot about how, and I, you know, just a second ago we were talking about me saying I didn't trust anyone with my writing. I was very precious about my writing, and I would work for hours on one paragraph and then burn it. You know, I was just, after you've ruined 85 books, you don't feel so precious about your own writing. You start to feel like, look, if I'm cutting up this person and turning it into, and I'm doing my best, but, you know, I'm taking someone else's book and chopping it up and turning it into something else, I can do that with my own and not feel so precious about it.
But you're boiling it down to action and dialogue.
Absolutely.
Which is,
you're focusing on the spoken version of a book, so you're paring back all of the descriptions of characters and the descriptions of settings. And if a phone call in a murder mystery takes place on page 22 and then they don't answer, well, you just cut to page 45 where they do answer the phone, and you've moved the plot forward that much more quickly. So that's how I learned to do it.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
My question's for Roman. In the movie, like the young girl, it's her mother who is having an affair. Was there a reason why it was the mother and not the father? Maybe because they were the same sex and it affected her differently?
You know, with the writing of that project, it was very intuitive and things just sort of happened. So there was never a discussion, oh, should it be the father or the mother, and deciding on the mother. Things would sort of happen where she would go outside to have a cigarette, and then, all of a sudden, the policeman would show up. And so I can't answer that honestly, but it just felt right, and it was an intuitive decision.
Go ahead.
I just have a brief comment, and that is that I really appreciate everyone on the panel's honesty and like willingness to share your experience. It's really refreshing, and so thank you very much. You. Just not used to it, and it's like surprising, and I just, it's like, wow, so thank you. my question is, you all kind of touched on this, but David and John, specifically, you mentioned when you're writing, you're also thinking about, in some regard, is this feasible for the studio to have a CGI tiger in the boat? Or, you know, with your movie, the same, like, what is the studio going to say? But there is the realistic aspect of that. Ideally, I guess, how much would you like, or how much does the studio side drive the creative content, you know?
Right. Well, the decision to make a film has a great bearing on, I mean, if you're looking at something, whether or not you're going to write this film, it is often a challenge. If you know going in, as he talked about with Flight, where it's a challenging project because it's R-rated, because of the budget, because you need to start it, there are obviously projects that have more of a challenge to them. Once a studio has agreed to make a film, at least with the first draft, they always say, oh, just go for it. You know, just write your biggest version of it. You know things. You can't have five parades in one film. They're going to cut it down to one. But you can put it in the first draft, and it's all great until they start breaking down the budget on it. And then you have to make creative decisions based on that. But often the decisions you make are better because it's forcing you to make new decisions. You know, all right, we have the five parades. We really didn't need five to begin with. This is the one that really matters. What can we do with those other scenes?
Yeah.
So it's more of a once you get to the realities of production, then you have to make those decisions.
I also think, I mean, let me also just speak for all of us to say, I think we're honored to be here. And it's really nice that people come out and want to hear what we have
Absolutely.
To say, because we're the people behind the people who say all the things that we tell them to say. So we really appreciate that.
Yes,
you know, like
you.
I was joking with these guys. We're all chatting backstage, and then all of a sudden I was like, oh my God, there's actual people in there. And walked up, there's all these people here. But I mean, for me, there's a big distinction between what I call the job and the work. So like the work is what we're talking about, which is like, I love the work. It's like, I joke about Real Steel, but the work on them, I had a great time. I've got kids, man. It was fun to come up with the robots and all the stuff that's going on. Like the work of that, like the actual writing work where you disappear into it and suddenly you're in this other world and you're writing things and you've got people talking about stuff and it's crazy. The job part is the job that sucks. The job is like you got a meeting at 10 a.m. and you got to go in there and you better wow them because they're kind of on the fence and they don't care about this or, you know, they're going to tell you they don't like this or like that. It's like the job can be a drag. That's what they pay you for the job. The work I would do for free. I'd pay people to get to do the work. It's like, but the job is that ain't good.
And we're done with the questions now because we have to wrap up. So before we completely finalize this, what are you each working on next as an exit?
I'm always a little superstitious about what I say I'm working on next because as soon as I speak it aloud, it goes into turnaround or something. It adds like 5 years to the process. But I have a pilot that I'm waiting to hear about. I have three films that I'm working on. One is animated and two that are in various stages of development. And I hope they're all next. So that's where I am with that.
I'm writing something, but I have the same kind of thing as
you're me. Sticking to original screenplays.
I'm writing another original thing. Yeah.
I don't really know. I mean, I'm producing a movie that Aaron Paul is going to play the lead in. That's a crazy car culture movie, which I'm really into, which is a completely different kind of thing. So, and it's a different role for me too in that. So, but I need to. You know, I'm going to write and direct a movie. I think if I keep saying I'm going to write and direct another movie, that ultimately I'll do it. So I'll just say, I'm going to write and direct another movie. I don't know what it is, but.
Roman, you're going to take this movie out that you just finished.
That's sort of my main job right now, to spread the word about this upcoming film. And after that, I'm just waiting for something to strike me. I'm just taking a little moment of
Can you tell us 1 second about Charlie Sheen?
I was going to ask him that, actually.
I could talk a lot.
One second.
Well, it's funny because people say, oh, what's he like? He's crazy. What was that? It was, must have been insane. But Charlie is super together, talented, witty, funny, charming, committed to make. When we made the movie, he was never late. He knew all his lines. So I have no good stories to tell because he was contrary to what you all expect. And if you see the film, I think you'll agree that he's good.
This is going to be an amazing thing. I just have this feeling.
Steven?
Oh, I'm writing my my second novel now, which I plan to make into a movie, adapt and direct as well, you know. And if I may, just really quickly, the young woman who asked that question, because you guys couldn't see her eyes, but she seemed to, just wanted to say, and I think everyone would agree here. Quick tangent. Ever since I directed my movie, I've been sent a lot of scripts, and to maybe direct the next thing. And you would be shocked how few good ones there are. Like truly good ones, like everybody here sitting here, we all like wrote good movies, and it's a tough thing to do. So don't ever be intimidated. It's like going back to the rules question. Don't ever be intimidated by the idea that there is some right way to do this. You know, if you tell a great story, people, trust me, they will find you. You know, mm-hmm. And yes, you might have to go through the thing where you can't have five parades, you got to get it down to one. That is practical and it's part of the job. But if you have a great story to tell, you're going to find an audience. And so I hope you don't ever think that what we say up here about anything in the business is anything other than encouraging.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you guys very much. You were great. Due to the red carpet outside for no, they're asking if you could all exit through the side doors. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay.